Tunisia, 1975. The Star Wars Company arrives at its first location. Besides conceiving and writing the film, George Lucas served as director. On such a complex project, that's at least one job too many, according to George. George co-wrote The Empire Strikes Back, oversaw pre- and post-production, and Irvin Kershner directed.
Keep moving the camera.
All the saga's directors. The newest member of a very exclusive club is Richard Marquand, right, who directed Jedi. In the desert near Yuma, Arizona, Richard would lead cast and crew through heat and sandstorms to complete one of Jedi's major sequences. We worked 4 weeks to realize what George and Richard had planned months before on a model. George was everywhere as we geared up to shoot. Here he's checking storyboards with designer Joe Johnston.
The battle of the big ships is still going on out beyond the Death Star, right?
Well, as the fighters go in, we assume that the rebel cruisers also start to go in.
Yeah.
He even turned up at my costume fitting.
This is actually quite similar to your outfit in the first film.
It is.
Just the black version that's a little bit more Jedi-like.
Jedi was more than a saga's climax. It offered George a chance few filmmakers get, the opportunity to improve on ideas, settings, and characters he had introduced in his earlier works.
It took so much effort to get up to speed, which was essentially to make the first film. And I created this great world, but I didn't have the fun of being able to run around in it. Now that I knew the world and I could see it, and it was a real thing, it brings up all kinds of ideas of things, and funny moments and adventures that you could have in that environment that you've created. And I never got to exploit that. And I always felt, in my first film, is that now if I went back and make another film in that environment, using those characters, I could make a hell of a better movie. I mean, it would just be infinitely more exciting and interesting and fascinating. Because the first one was just trying to, you're in a foreign environment, and you just don't know what's going on. And it's the same for the author as it is for the audience.
Remember the Star Wars cantina? Everyone loved it, except George. This was one of the things he always thought could be done better sometime.
Well, I'd always wanted to have the cantina be more than what it was. It was originally designed to be lots of very exotic creatures, and when I shot it, I just didn't have the money, and the makeup man was ill and couldn't finish the masks, and so I was always left with sort of a less articulated monsters and less effective scene than I thought was necessary.
This is the monster rally of George's dreams. The setting is the palace of Jabba the Hutt, godfather of the galaxy and host to aliens from a thousand worlds. Jabba's band was designed by Phil Tippett. He's head of the creature shop at Industrial Light and Magic. More than 80 creatures lurked in the shadows of Jabba's palace. That's more monsters by far than have ever been assembled for a single movie. They all began to take shape like this, as small models called maquettes. Most of them were sculpted over and over again before they were approved. A team of 15 artists, aided by other craftsmen, worked 13 months, the last six of them on a day and night basis, to translate the maquettes into full-scale clay models of puppets and masks. Well over $1 million was spent on creature development and construction. Molds were made from the clay models. From these, the monstrous faces and forms took shape in latex and rubber. Painting was painstaking. The creatures had to have that lived-in look. Maybe they were not of this earth, but they had to seem as if they were of some earth somewhere. The young Frankensteins frequently cracked up each other. It was a way of easing the strain of a long, hard job.
Make way, take in transit.
Even when the masks and costumes were molded and painted, the work wasn't finished. For most of the featured creatures had to be able to express themselves. Some of these pig guards, for instance, would have a large range of facial movements available for their close shots. The muscles controlling expression were actually either wire cables or air tubes connected to a bellows out of camera range. Over the months of work, something of the personalities of their creators just naturally worked its way into the finished creatures. Cy Snoodles, lead singer in Jabba's band, began her career as a dancer. But Max Rebo was first and last a keyboard artist. George made frequent visits to check on the progress of the creatures as they were being developed.
Oh, that's great. Yeah, it's like a...
Joel's way to open the door and do it.
It's like he's coming down to the... One of the more amusing things will be to have this... Have a vocalist.
How about Snooty?
So we can have her be the singer.
Sure.
Yeah, it'd be great.
She's got such a tiny little mouth.
She's going to sing lyrics. We're going to have to articulate her mouth.
Well, yeah, it would have to be a... What it means is we'd have to figure out a way of opening the mouth and making it at least open and close. Thing is, it doesn't have to be articulate. All it has to do is be able to open and close. It's a binary system, which it goes like this, 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 wow, this. And that gives us some room to come up with some lyrics and make a song. And also give us a great way to spotlight.
Miss Snooty's basic movements were provided by puppeteer Tim Rose, working below her stage. His legs were connected to hers by rods, so she could duplicate his steps precisely. Her microphone was also controlled from below stage, also by a rod. This, in turn, controlled movement of Snooty's snoot, which was connected to the mic by a wire that would be invisible in the final film. More wires connect Snooty's upper body with another operator, who works her as if she were a giant marionette. Her song was written in English, but translated into Hatties, Jabba's official court language. Pack-up night in the creature shop turned into a farewell party. Came the dawn, time to go.
Hey, did you hear that? We're going to England! Oh boy, hey Edgar, get your suitcase! Hey, say, does anybody know what the in-flight movie is? Oh, I hope it's rated.
Their destination? Elstree Studios outside London, where Jabba's palace stood empty and waiting for them to land.
Hello. You.
Hey, did everybody go to lunch? What's going on here? Hey.
Hello, NTV land.
They were a bit disoriented at first. Even Salacious B. Crumb, Jabba's right-hand bird. Tim Rose spoke for him.
Hey, Edgar. What'd you bring me to a place like this for? Look at all these freaks around here. It's really disgusting. That one over there, I don't even know what it is. Can't tell what's the head and what's the tail. Ugh. And that Jabba guy, old Big J as we call him around here, well, he's the worst of all.
Jabba was certainly the hardest of all to create. George said his first design looked too human. Second try, too snail-like. Number three was just right. Jabba was the largest, most complex puppet ever built for a movie. He was constructed the same way the smaller creatures were. His head and neck had to accommodate two main operators. They would be joined, for most shots, by other puppeteers located elsewhere in Jabba's body. Jabba's eyes and some of his facial muscles were radio-controlled by two more operators. Stuart Freeborn headed the team that executed Phil Tippett's designs in England. It took 3 months to build Jabba, and he cost close to $500,000.
In the film Star Wars, there was a scene with Jabba himself. He was always intended to be this loathsome, large, monstrous creature. But it wasn't possible to incorporate my design of Jabba when we shot the scene with the actors on the set. So I came up with the idea of shooting the scene with a man, and eventually I would mat in a stop-motion creature over the man.
Kolo!
This is the scene George shot for Star Wars, but decided not to finish.
Solo!
Right here, Jabba. I've been waiting for you.
Have you not?
You didn't think I was going to run, did you?
Ah, my boy. There are times you disappoint me. Why haven't you paid me? And why did you have to fry poor Greedo like that, after all we've been through together?
Look, Jabba, next time you want to talk to me, come see me yourself. Don't send one of these twerps.
Han. Understand, I just can't afford to make exceptions.
When we came to Jedi, I was able to redesign the monster, start from scratch. In the first film, the fact that he was walking and certain things, you know, demanded a certain type of creature. This way I was able to have more freedom in creating the creature and make him an even more interesting character than he had originally been designed in the first film.
Jabba needed a lot of help getting around. Finished, he weighed over 2,000 pounds. He also needed help getting himself, not to mention his act, together. Here's a working drawing of Jabba, showing where his heart and soul, his operators, were located.
I operate Jabba's right arm and the jaw of his mouth, and I do the voice at the moment to make the lip sync. And between Toby and myself, we do the body movements, the rocking of the whole figure. And
yeah, well, I'm the silent brain hemisphere. I do the left hand and the tongue, and that goes in here, and my right hand is free inside the head. And basically works this head control, tipping it left and right, front and back and up and down. I have one other control that can swivel the head, revolve it. And for certain shots I have things like the tongue here, my hand goes. I have a couple of cable controls that do snarls around the mouth. And using my feet and the weight of my body, I share with David the job of actually moving the body about.
These hand controls here, these two, operate the twitches around the corners of the mouth, middle of the mouth, lower jaw, and also the nostrils. And my feet work the bellows, which in turn works the respiratory system of the beast, the lungs.
The smoke from this cigar is for Jabba. When he smokes his pipe, I blow it up the tube and it trickles out of the corner of his mouth. If I was drinking port, it would be a perfect job.
Now this is the middle part of the tail, and this little bit is the little end piece, which the way I move it depends on the mood he's in at the time. If he's in a bit of an irritable mood, I just do the little flips like you'd bang your fingers if you was losing your temper or impatient. Or if he's really losing his temper, give it a good old thrash on like that, or backwards and forwards. And if he's in a lazy mood, you just keep it like that, nice steady movement.
But I tell you, Jabba's getting very good.
Is he?
Yes, he's getting very good. He's almost star now.
Oh, good.
We have to be very nice.
I like his tattoo.
He is what he is. That's the thing. He doesn't pretend to be anything else. He doesn't feel the need to be charming or anything. He's just an unpretentious, very straightforward guy.
Can you munch your lips again, Dave?
Nothing. 10 puppeteers and 9 mime artists, along with 42 extras and 18 principals, supported by a crew of 90, worked almost a month to make this sequence. Communication between the masked players, Jabba's hidden operators, and the rest of the cast and crew was a problem. A makeup person was assigned to Jabba full time. Relatively speaking, the rest of us required much less attention.
Bit on the
eye. He's now got the idea, so her rope is coming in very well. And on a shot of your two hands doing it without her in the background, and just some.
Hey, sweetheart, I like your threads. Sorry.
Yeah, I'll bring him
you
in.
Think
that
that'll work that way?
Yeah, I think it'll work very well.
I'll do it without moving my mouth, so if you decide not to use it.
Red light, let's go. Settle down, please.
Sorry, matey, just a little foreground smoke, please. Yes, please.
Don't talk. Turn over.
The heart of the scene. Luke confronts Jabba. The fate of his captured friends at stake.
And action.
You will bring Captain Solo and the Wookiee to me. On set, one of Jabba's operators spoke his lines in English. His awesome voice, speaking Huttese, was added later.
Your mind powers will not work on me, boy.
Nevertheless, I'm taking Captain Solo and his friends. You can either profit by this, or be destroyed. It's your choice, but I warn you not to underestimate my power.
Master Luke, you're standing on...
Mango Man Chico Ha! Oh, Jedi! Chor Tanya Wish Achanichu!
When Richard Marquand called cut, it was a relief, especially for the actors working under the mask. They were stifling. When there wasn't time to unmask, cool air was blown in.
Okay, I think I'll survive for a while.
All right.
No.
No, the floor drops away. I just go into a tuck and roll, and the most dangerous part of the stunt is getting out of the way of the Gamorrean guard that falls on top of me because he weighs about 200 pounds.
That's played by me.
Backing up, and the pig is right here trying to get into the thing. So
George and his staff study temporary shots in the editing room.
Roar, and he's maybe looking at Luke, and then he turns.
This footage will guide the making of the final scene.
All right, now here is the shot that has to be done with taste. Taking it like here, where we get the pig guard right in there, and the mouth just starts to come down on it. And then we cut away. What I want him to do is turn around and look at Luke, and then, as he's looking, you know, the hand is sort of dangling out of his hand, and he's chewing as he turns, and he, you know, slurps it up, gobbles it up, and the hand disappears.
Ooh,
down his, yeah, you know,
that's the beginning.
Yeah. And then starts to move forward.
Art director Joe Johnston sketches the new ideas. From his sketches, Joe created a storyboard for Phil Tippett, who played the Rancor in this early incarnation. Yes, that's Phil underneath that rubber suit. Dennis Muren directed miniature special effects photography. His colleagues, Richard Edlund and Ken Ralston, did our space shots. The technique for animating a classic fairy tale situation, the dragon in his lair, is itself a classic. It was used in Japanese monster movies like Godzilla. The filmmakers hoped to improve it enough to use it in the final film, especially Phil, who found his role inspiring.
Raise the gate.
In the end, though, the Rancor's cave was reduced to snugger proportions. It was about 30 inches high. The Rancor himself was scaled down to an 18-inch puppet. Phil's hand animated his head. Rods moved the rest of his body. He was photographed in slow motion, so his movements would appear massive and menacing.